Hello friends, welcome to Awdhesh Academy. Friends, one of the very important thing in the goods and services taxes to assess the tax liability. Every SSE is required to assess his own tax liability and deposit that money to the government. And therefore, assessment is one of the most important feature of GST. So today we are going to learn about the different types of assessment which are there in the GST. And then we will go into details in the subsequent lessons. Let us first understand what is the meaning of assessment. Assessment is defined in the GST Act as to mean determination of tax liability under this act and includes self-assessment, reassessment, provisional assessment, summary assessment, and best judgment assessment. So that means the assessment has not been defined in a manner that what actually it is. It is having an inclusive definitions, that means these things are also included, that means self-assessment, other things which are included in that. But assessment basically means to assess your own duty and deposit it, that is the meaning of assessment. Now the question is, when the taxpayer has to discharge the tax liability? Normal cases, the taxpayer should discharge the liability based on what type of supplies he is making, supplies of goods or supplies of services, or the combination of both. But in certain cases, even when he is not actually supplying anything but only receiving certain supplies, in that case also liability will arise and he has to assess the duty if that item is covered under the reverse charge mechanism. So we have to understand there are two types of cases when the assessment becomes necessary. One, when he is providing an output service. Number two, when he is receiving a service which is covered under reverse charge mechanism. So when he is providing an output service, he has to discharge the output tax. And output tax is defined under the GST Act to means the tax chargeable under the GST Act on taxable supply of goods or services or both made by the taxpayer or by his agent, but it excludes the tax payable by him on reverse charge basis. That means all the taxes which he or his agents is providing, that will covered under the output supply and he has to discharge the output tax. This definition is provided under section 282 of the GST Act. Now let us go to the definition of the reverse charge. Reverse charge means the liability to pay tax by the recipient of the supply of goods or services or both instead of the supplier of such goods or services or both. And this is defined under section 298. So when certain type of supplies are covered under the reverse charge mechanism, then instead of the supplier, the recipient has to pay the taxes and he has to fulfill all the liabilities of the assessment and filing of the return, payment of the taxes, etc. Now let us first know what is self-assessment. Self-assessment means every person registered under the GST should himself assess the tax payable by him for a tax period, file the periodic return and deposit the tax in the account of the government. So we have to understand one very important thing here, that the liability of the tax arises the moment you provide a service. But you are not going to deposit the tax on the same day. So the government has provided a period for depositing the taxes. So within that period, you will deposit the tax and you will also submit the return, which will tell as to how this liability or how that tax has been calculated. So this procedure is called self-assessment. Now let us understand the concept of reassessment. If the SSE finds some mistakes in his self-assessment, he can reassess the tax liability of his own and do reassessment within the prescribed period. That means suppose you have submitted the returns, you have also paid the tax liability according to the returns, but you have found that some mistake has occurred. In that situation, you can reassess the return and you can reassess the tax liability and pay that to the government account, and this is called reassessment. Sometime what happened that the proper officer, while doing the scrutiny of the return, he finds that there is some mistake in your returns, and then he can point out that this is the mistake, and then you reassess that and again make a payment. So this is called reassessment. Let us now understand the meaning of scrutiny of return. The taxpayers are required to file regular returns, either monthly or quarterly, and sometime on the annual basis also. So when they are filing the return, those returns are available to the officers for scrutiny. Now the government keep prescribing the norms of scrutiny from time to time. It can be on the basis of random numbers or on the basis of some information it can be done, or it can be provided by the government that this particular class of SSCs must be compulsorily scrutinized. So all that has been decided by the government, and it is not necessary that the returns has to be scrutinized. They are only done on the selective basis. Now when the proper officer who is doing the scrutiny of the return finds that there is some mistake in the return, in that case he will intimate to the taxpayer that this is the mistake and please correct this mistake, or you give your explanation as to why this mistake has happened. So the taxpayer has the option to reassess the tax liability and make suitable changes in the returns. In that case, the matter is over, the return is revised and the tax liability is fulfilled. Now, sometime what happens that the SSC does not agree with the observation which has been made by the proper officer. So if suppose he does not give any explanation to the proper officer or fail to give any satisfactory explanation within 30 days when the proper officer has asked him to provide the explanation, in that case the proper officer may order for audit, investigation, search, etc. when the investigation will be done, and thereafter a demand notice will be issued and the party will be forced to pay the taxes after following the due procedure of law. So scrutiny of the return is something which is not compulsory, but it can point out certain mistakes, and if the SSC correct it, there is no issues. If the SSC does not correct it, then further process will follow. Let us now understand what is provisional assessment. Where the taxable person is unable to determine the value or rate of tax of the supplies, he may request for assessment on provisional basis. That means sometimes what happens that we do not know what is the exact value of the supplies. Sometimes we do not know what is the correct rate of tax on the supplies. In that case, the SSC has the option that he can request the proper officer that let my taxes be assessed on the provisional basis, that means temporary basis, till we finalize the rate of taxes and the value. In that case, the proper officer shall allow the provisional assessment after execution of bond and finalize the assessment within the specified period. So the purpose of the provisional assessment is that some time will be given to the taxpayer so that he has the clarity about the rate of duty or the value of the supply, and then final assessment can be done. So it is the option of the SSC, and we shall be dealing with the provisional assessment separately in a different lesson. The next type of assessment is called summary assessment. Now summary assessment can be done when the proper officer believes that any delay in doing so may adversely affect the interest of the revenue, and the summary assessment is done with the previous permission of the additional or joint commissioner of the GST. So sometime what happens that if you don't do the assessment right now, then a revenue may be lost. We cannot wait for the due process to carry on before the assessment, and in that case summary assessment can be resorted. Now the provision also says that if the taxable person is not ascertainable and such liability pertains to the supply of the goods, the person in charge of such goods shall be deemed to be the taxable person. Now let me explain the situations in which such type of assessment can be done. Now for example, if the tax officer finds that on a truck certain goods are loaded on which the GST has to be paid. However, he finds that there is no evidence of payment of any GST and the party is not carrying any document. The driver is not carrying any document. Now when he asks these documents from the driver, he fails to provide the documents, or the SSC name which he provides actually does not exist or is not found or is fake. In that situation, we do not know who is the real owner of the goods. In that situation, there is a provision that the person in charge of such goods, that means in this case the driver, he shall be deemed to be the taxable person, and in that case we can recover the duties accordingly. In the same way, suppose you raid a godown and in the godown you find a huge amount of tax paid material but no liability has been discharged. In that case, the owner of the warehouse can be deemed to be the owner of the goods and the tax liability can accrue accordingly. Now, suppose what happens that you have done the summary assessment, but in certain situation it can be withdrawn also. So let us go to the relevant provision. The additional commissioner or the joint commissioner may withdraw such order and follow the procedure laid down under section 73 or 74 by issue of a demand within 30 days from the receipt of the order if he considered that such order is erroneous. That means if the additional commissioner or the joint commissioner find that this type of summary assessment is not proper, in that case he can withdraw that order, and the proper procedures for recovery of the duty, which is provided under section 73 and 74 by issue of the demand and all that, that can be done by the additional or joint commissioner. Now, in addition to that, there is another form of assessment which is called best judgment assessment. Now, this best judgment assessment is resorted when an SSC is not filing the return, that means he is a non-filer, or he has not even registered with the GST, that means an unregistered person. Now, the law provides that if a taxable person fail to obtain registration, even though he is liable to do so, or whose registration has been cancelled but who was liable to pay tax, the proper officer may proceed to assess the tax liability of such taxable person to the best of his judgment for the relevant tax period. Thus, there are two situations in this category. That means a person is not registered under GST, even though he should have been registered because he is liable to pay the taxes, or he has registered but it has been cancelled due to certain violations, but his tax liability is still there. In that situation, the best judgment assessment can be resorted to. In that case, what happens that the proper officer will issue an assessment order within a period of 5 years from the date of furnishing of the annual return for the financial year to which the tax is not paid relate. That means within 5 years, the proper officer can do this best judgment assessment. So normally what happens that this financial year's annual return will be filed in the next financial year, and therefore from 5 years from that period can be taken for doing the best judgment assessment. However, it has been specifically provided that no such assessment order shall be passed without giving the person an opportunity to be heard. So that means the opportunity has to be given to the taxpayers. He will be allowed an opportunity to represent his case. Personal hearing may also be given, and only after hearing his side of the story, then only the best judgment assessment will be passed. So it is not a random thing. It is not the absolute discretion of the officer. He has to give an opportunity to the taxpayer. So friends, today we have learned about the different types of assessment which are there in the GST laws, and we shall be learning more about it, how to calculate the tax liability, in the subsequent lesson. Thank you very much for watching the video.